theme song. It's catchy. It's full of pep and vigor.
It is catchy. That's what I was hoping for. I was hoping for whimsy. That's what I was hoping for.
Yeah, it's wacky.
Yeah, I work with this regular woman, who was in Seattle and has moved to Australia.
Yowza.
A day, and she, anytime I need a piece of original music, I go to her, and she, and we have a lot of fun working together. So I'm just kind of like, I'm looking for this, I'm looking for that, and we went through so many different strange iterations, because, like, she doesn't have a theremin. You know, you don't meet many people who do have a theremin, but
yeah.
She tried to get a theremin sound with her voice. You know? That was an early rendition, and she sent me a copy of that, and I was like, that's good, but it's too creepy. I don't want to go quite that creepy. You know what
yeah.
I mean? I didn't think that really caught us, you know? So I was I was showing her clips on YouTube of like 60s sci-fi shows like Lost in Space and shit, and then I would go over to classic cartoons like Top Cat and, you know,
nice.
The Flintstones, all that. I was just like, you know, we just need more whimsy. By the way, welcome to the Pope on Film. I'm Funny Williams, and with me is
Reverend Steve, the founder of the Church of Ed Wood. It's been around since 1996, and it's at edwood.org, and you should check that out. And by the way, Top Hat is a huge character, incredibly popular in Mexico.
Top Hat,
yeah, in fact, a couple of years ago, they released a new Top Hat movie in Mexico, and that was always like a head-scratcher for me that I never understood. That and Morrissey's popularity, specifically within the Mexican community, I find that to be a bit odd.
Morrissey, I hadn't heard of that one either.
Yeah, I've read a couple of articles about Morrissey's popularity within the Mexican community, which is, like, surprising. Because it's Morrissey, but...
Yeah.
Top
Cat was one of my favorites when I was a kid.
Not exactly sure what about Top Cat is so popular within the Mexican community, but, you know, that's just odd. Why not Magilla Gorilla or Captain Caveman? I don't know why specifically Top Cat, but that's just odd to me.
I don't know, The most amazing tidbit about Top Cat is that it was a pack of cats, a pack of street cats. So they were kind of like gangsterish and everything. So it was Top Cat, and then he had like his crew. And one of his crew was Choo Choo. And Choo Choo was voiced by the guy from One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. Charlie Cheswick.
Cheswick.
The one who was yelling on and on about his cigarettes, and he was in a lot of other shit. One Flew Over the Cuckoo's
I played the part of Cheswick in a theatrical production of One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest in Scottsdale, Arizona in the 90s. That was good.
Did you do, like, the movie version, or did you do the original?
We did the play version.
Uh-huh.
And I would make people cry at the end. I did this one specific thing where, you know, what's his name? McMurphy is just laying there and he's all catatonic, but I hold his hand anyway, and not a dry eye in the house.
Yeah.
Not a dry eye. Because I was such an amazing actor.
That one was told more from the chief's perspective, wasn't it?
Yeah.
The play version? Yeah.
I haven't done a play in forever, but I used to be like Mr. Play in Phoenix, Arizona. But it's not too difficult to become Mr. Play in Phoenix, Arizona. But anyway.
There's
a large amount of local theater in Phoenix, Arizona. So it's not like it's difficult to get apart.
That's what I was thinking. They probably don't cotton to that much in Oklahoma.
No. No, they don't. Not experimental theater. I got into this experimental theater group for a while called Feast of Fools Productions. One of the things that the head of the group, Michael Alessandro, one of the things that he liked doing is getting rights with finger quotes to do play versions of movies and seeing how long he could do those play versions of the movies until the studio tried to shut him down.
I was in the
world premiere stage version of Reservoir Dogs and Pulp Fiction. Pulp Fiction was an interesting play to do because, hey, do you like the movie Pulp Fiction? How about watching it but an hour longer and with people you don't know? Isn't that a wonderful idea?
It is a unique and interesting concept. I would have to give it that at least.
I was upset when I did Reservoir Dogs and I was Mr. Brown. The director did not want me changing any of the lines, but I really thought that since I'm Mr. Brown, instead of saying Mr. Brown, that's more like that's like Mr. Shit. I wanted to change it. Why am I Mr. Brown? Is it racist? Is it because I'm Mexican? Why can't I be Mr. Yellow or Mr. Red? Why does it have to be Mr. Brown? This is racist. And he's like, no, you can't change a single word of dialogue. And I was upset about that.
Oh,
but that was Mr. Brown.
Yeah. I would have gone for that.
It made sense to me.
If I was directing that, I would have gone for that and sort of rewrite that scene right there.
Yeah. It made sense to me.
Because I could picture the other character just being, you can't be Mr. Red. We got an Indian down there on another job who's Mr. Red.
Yeah.
just crank up that racism a bit higher.
Yeah. How's the weather over there on your corner of the world?
It has been serious.
Really?
We have been going from like negative degree temperatures, like that, like we've been down to 19, 20 below.
Jesus.
And as soon as it warms up, well, of course, in true Colorado fashion, it would snap to life for like one day and it would be up in like in the 60s, heading to the 70s. And then it would immediately drop off again. Like you would get a day like that. And then it'll drop off, and as it's cooling back down, it'll hit the point where it can snow, and we've been getting a lot of snow, and then it goes back into the sub-teen temperatures. So it's been fun. It's been a Colorado ride.
It's been pretty warm over here, but the thing is that I'm in Oklahoma, and in Oklahoma we get tornadoes, and now we get a crap ton of earthquakes, and so it's an important job to be a weatherman on TV. But the weather people on TV, they automatically, it's ridiculous here in Oklahoma, they automatically go for the absolute worst.
Yeah.
It is so, for the last 2 weeks, they've been saying things like, you're going to get rain and ice and sleet. You're going to want to stay indoors. You're not going to want to leave. If you're going to leave early. Use caution. The roads are going to be ice. One day I woke up and I turned on the news before I went to work and Channel 4. And they're notorious for this sort of stuff. The roads are ice. There are cars literally littering the streets. Because it is an ice rink out there. It is dangerous to be outside. And so I left like 2.5 hours early. And it's absolutely perfect outside. They said that today that it was going to be like a 60% chance of snow. And it was going to be with the severe wind chill. It was going to be down to the teens. But I'm actually doing this outside right now. Because it's like in the 40s or 50s. It's beautiful outside right now. is a beautiful, beautiful day.
Nice.
The news just absolutely just loves panicking people. The last time that we had some tornadoes and we had a little bit of flooding. And News Channel 4 specifically said that if you can't get to a shelter, you are going to die. And they were telling people that they should try to get into storm drains or into the sewer, because that's not the best shelter you'll get, but at least it'll protect you from the tornado. So a bunch of people did that and then drowned to death.
Oh, God.
Because of the flash flooding.
Yeah.
That's the sort of panicky nature that happens with Oklahoma. Like, literally, one snowflake will fall, and then the news will just be, "It snowed again in Oklahoma, you're all gonna die!" It's really amazing. I love it, if anything, because I just love watching drama, I guess?
Yeah.
But it really is a wonderful thing. Really is a wonderful thing to watch. There'll be times when I'll be at work and there'll be nobody at my work. And the reason there'll be nobody at my work is that the news for 3 days have been saying, "Wednesday is going to be hell. Do not leave your home." And so nobody's leaving despite the fact that it's just a perfect day outside. Like today. Ah, it's wonderful. Wonderful. I love drama and I love other people suffering. So it's pretty awesome.
Yeah. Before getting into it, I want to give a couple of shout-outs. There have been a lot of people on Twitter that have been supporting us and retweeting when we post about a new show and things like that, retweeting our tweets or whatever, and twiddling our tweets. I'm not a big Twitter fan.
That sounded dirty.
but we have, and this is all by the like Twitter handles or whatever you would call them. At Cooper Hollins, he retweeted us a couple of times. Nick Simonis, he also retweeted us. At Cerebus Ent, which is, I think, Cerebus Entertainment, retweeted us. Our absolute biggest supporter, though, Glenn of the Bride, who retweets us everywhere he finds us. And
that's wonderful.
Every message, you know, because like I'll put out tweets at, you know, I have a different Twitter account for each of the shows.
You know,
so I'll put it out on Dead Cow Studios, Dying Generation, Pope on Film, and Destination Utopia. You know, everyone that he is following us on, he retweets. So, good for that. So, he's a huge supporter of us. And he is at Edwood Recut on Twitter. So, that's where you want to find him. At Agent Bertram, I don't know if he's like an actual agent. Is he a Hollywood agent? Is he a detective? You know? Is he a TV or comic book character I'm not familiar with?
I do not know. These are all very valid questions.
Agent Bertram.
Maybe he's
law.
An agent of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Maybe. It's a very dramatic name. It's a name I like a lot. I kind of wish that was my Twitter handle. Agent Bertram. Teresa Kramer. At Teresa Kramer. She retweeted us. At Donatos and at Ermagard Drawn. I think that is. But thank you, everybody. We appreciate the support. We thank you. We're glad to hear that you're out there and listening. One of these people, I forget which one, liked the video on YouTube for the Guardians of the Galaxy. So,
well, that was a good episode.
Thank you,
that Guardians of the Galaxy one. That was a good one.
That was a good episode, yes. Well,
but
I won.
It's
the first first one or two.
Well, yeah, they've all been really good episodes, but I don't want to get stuck just doing episodes about, you know, obscure things. I just want to, every once in a while, throw like a curveball where it's like, okay, here's a made-for-TV movie. Here's a black and white horror movie from the 50s. Now we're going to do Dolphin Tale 2. Or, you know, Hulk Hogan's No Holds Barred.
Or some sort of, I don't know, Into the Woods. You know, just throw people for a loop every once in a while.
Yeah, my problem is that I get so busy that, you know, when I try to think of a movie, I just, like, tend to grab whatever's close, you know.
And that helps out, I think that helps out our listeners, because a lot of times, you know, I'll be talking to someone here in Oklahoma about my podcast, and they'll say, what type of movies do you guys focus on in your podcast? And I'm, because of what you just said, I'm able to say,
easily accessible ones.
At least, yeah, that's kind of, you know, granted, Guardians of the Galaxy isn't, but that was still worth doing. But as we can, if it's on YouTube or possibly Netflix, a lot of people have Netflix, so that's cool. Or even archive.org.
Yeah.
Which there's a particular movie I'm thinking of that I would like to do at some point that I know is pretty much only on archive.org. It might be on YouTube now. I'd have to look again.
I'm in an episode of Cinema Insomnia that I believe is available on archive.org.
That's on archive.org, yeah?
I was in the Bucket of Blood episode, and I was in the episode featuring Star Crash.
Star Crash, right. Yeah, Bucket of Blood was the one I wasn't exactly remembering. I remember that you were in the Star Crash episode. But there is an amazing silent movie that a lot of people haven't heard of called Haxan.
Called what?
Haxan. H-A-X-E-N.
Okay.
But it's like Swedish or something like that, so that's probably where that name comes from. But it is about the witch trials.
Hmm.
And it is a very strange, interesting movie. If not for anything else, but for thinking about a silent movie and being like, I fucking can't believe they just went there.
Yeah.
You know, because you think of, I don't know, man, you think about that whole time period, like the 20s and things like that, and people being like all innocent and stuff, and no, we are always what we are.
Yeah.
You know, the human race really hasn't changed much. We might cover it up better at some points in history than others, you know.
Yeah.
But, so at some point, that one's on the list for us. I would really like us to check that one out. And we have not done a silent movie, you know.
Yeah. It's been a while since I've watched a silent movie.
Yeah.
During high school, I tried to trick myself into thinking that I was really into Charlie Chaplin films. But I'm not sure if I was really into Charlie Chaplin films or if I was just trying to get into them so I could tell people I was into Charlie Chaplin films.
Yeah.
I think it was more that than actually liking them.
He is like a few other people. I am into Charlie Chaplin. Not so into Charlie Chaplin movies.
Yeah.
You know, I love the hell out of John Waters. Not a huge fan of the movies.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Kind of like that.
That's wildly understandable.
So, you know, I tend to like most of the classic horror silent movies. And Haxan is one I came across, and it's just so bizarre. So
that
what about the homework? What's this puck golf stuff?
Oh, the homework, yes. The homework this week
was to watch a specific episode of Cheap Seats. The specific episode I picked because I think it's just overall it's a really good episode, but I had a really hard time picking that specific episode because they did 77 episodes of Cheap Seats from the beginning of 2004 to the end of 2006, and they're all hilarious. Each and every episode of Cheap Seats is wonderful. When I first heard about Cheap Seats, I was worried that I wasn't going to like it or that I wasn't going to get it because we're talking about a comedy show that aired on ESPN Classic, and I know nothing of sports. I know absolutely nothing of sports. So I figured that 90% of these jokes were going to just completely go over my head. And they do a number of sports references that I don't get, but it's surprisingly few and far between. Anybody can sit down and watch the show and love it. It aired on ESPN Classic, and right there is why I refer to this show on my blog as the funniest show that no one's ever seen. Because when you think comedy, you don't think ESPN Classic. That's the worst place in the world for an original, funny, smart comedy to be airing is on ESPN fucking Classic. It would play on ESPN Classic late at night after reruns of Arliss. Remember Arliss? When was the last time you heard Arliss?
I am actually not familiar.
It was a show, and they used to play it on HBO, and it starred Robert Wool as a like a sports agent. And every episode, they would have one actual sports quote unquote celebrity in the episode, and it was really, really stupid, like incredibly stupid.
Yeah.
And so they would play reruns of Arliss and then Cheap Seats. 77 episodes. It was hosted by twins called, their names are Randy and Jason Sklar. They have a comedy special on Netflix that's absolutely wonderful. And essentially, it's Mystery Science Theater, but it's two twins making fun of some of the absolutely bizarre things that they've shown on on ESPN. Because not only have they shown sports, but they've shown lawnmower racing, bull riding, the running of the bulls, creative breaking, which is breaking things in a creative fashion.
Okay.
Spelling bees, a Steve Garvey celebrity fishing tournaments. They've shown some weird stuff on ESPN. Originally, it was an hour long. I think they did 10 episodes that were an hour long. And it was shot in New York City, and because Randy and Jason have been doing stand-up for so long, they used a lot of local comedians, a number of comedians. Pretty much in every episode, there's some amazing person that shows up. Like, God, there are so many people who have appeared on Cheap Seats. Zach Galifianakis, Paul Rudd, David Cross, Ed Helms, Patton Oswalt, Kristen Schaal's in one. Michael Ian Black is in one or two episodes. And it really is the funniest show in the world. I mentioned this in passing, I think, in the last episode, but we were going on a family vacation to Disneyland, and I lived in Sacramento, California at the time, and we drove from Sacramento to L.A., and it took a number of hours, and by the time we got there, I was just so excited to go to Disneyland, but my wife was pregnant at the time, and so she just said, I have to take a nap before we do anything, and, you know, we're inches away from Disneyland, but no, I have to take a nap, and I go, okay, I'll just wander around outside and not go anywhere in particular. No, you can't go to Disneyland without us. And I'm like, oh, God damn it. Okay, fine. I guess I'll just stay in this room. I didn't want to go to Disneyland anyway, so this will be fun. And I turned on the TV, and it was an all-day Cheap Seats marathon.
and I have no idea what this is, but I'll give it a try. And then my wife woke up like 3 or 4 hours later, and she just looked at me and said, "Did you go to Disneyland?" And I said, "No, but this is the most amazing show in the world. I've been laughing so hard. It's called Cheese Dance, and we got to..." But I made her not go to Disneyland so that she could stay and watch Cheese Dance. And that says something about this show that I'm like, yeah, sure, Disneyland, but you got to see this TV show. I fell in absolute love with this show, and it's just amazing. The majority of the episodes are available for free on YouTube, and it really is a shame that this show did not become huge. It's a shame that this show isn't known, because it's a hilarious show. It is absolutely hilarious. Did you watch it? What did you think of it?
I was very upset that I was not seeing more little castles and frogs and stuff like that. I really think that they have to work on the tournament, because, look, nobody's showing up to this tournament to watch them putt.
I thought that putt-putt was miniature golf. So, I was unaware of the existence of putt-putt. But apparently putt-putt doesn't have the windmills and the waterfalls and all that sort of stuff.
I don't know. I don't know. I thought putt-putt was just a, like a big name in the miniature golf industry.
Yeah, it's a bit odd. But I love this episode. I love Cheap Seats. It's just the greatest show in the world, and I love it. I'm in love with this show. I am in love with Randy and Jason. Every episode is just an absolute blast. Oh, I love this show. And I figured if I was going to assign homework, then I would. The homework that I have picked so far have just been things I want to share with people. And Cheap Seats is definitely something that I want to share with people, because I love this show. I feel passionate about this show. And, last time it was on the air was 2006, and yet I still think that this is one of the funniest shows that's ever been created. And, if you have a spare, 21 minutes, they're all right there on YouTube, and they're hilarious, and you can pick any one and watch it, and it's just absolutely wonderful. Everybody should be watching this show. Just something for you to think about if you got some time to kill. Cheap Seats.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think the episode that was on YouTube played the entire beginning to Cheap Seats, but the first episode of Cheap Seats is Cheap Seats with Ron Parker, and Ron Parker is played by Michael Showalter from The State and from the movie Wet Hot American Summer, and he's the host, and he keeps mistreating his tape librarians, Randy and Jason, but then there's an accident in the first episode, and so Randy and Jason, who are sitting 2 and 3 on the hosting depth chart, they have to take over the show. So they take over Cheap Seats, so that's why for the first couple of seasons it was called Cheap Seats Without Ron Parker. But I think it was the end of the third season, Ron Parker comes back and tries to take over the show again. It's during one of their Spelling Bee episodes. It's a two-parter, and it's absolutely hilarious. Oh, it's just a wonderful show. One of the things that I love, I honestly feel that if it was on ESPN, Prime, or even ESPN2, then, that would have been a better fit, and it would have been a lot more popular, but they buried this thing on ESPN Classic. I don't even know too many people who have ESPN Classic, let alone how many people actually watch it. And I know that there's no one out there who watches ESPN Classic for comedy. So it's just a shame. Each episode is perfect. And I cannot speak
more highly of the show. It holds a special place in my heart. I quote it like some people quote The Godfather or Fletch. I quote Cheap Seats. I quote Cheap Seats episodes like some people quote Anchorman. Like sometimes when I'll see like a husband and wife and they're wearing the same clothes, I'll lean over to my daughter or I'll lean over to my wife and I'll be like, hey, who are they? Putt-putt legends Dick and Evelyn Florn. And we'll all have a hearty laugh.
Uh-huh.
Cheap Seats. I love Cheap Seats. Can you tell that I love Cheap Seats?
It kind of shows through a little bit. I'm going to have to watch a few more episodes. I kind of like how the first guy banked the golf ball and made the hole in one.
Yeah.
And I think he was the only one that I saw make a hole in one.
Yeah. I also like Guy with Clipboard, a tour staple.
I was upset at the apparent sexual discrimination in the miniature golf community.
Yes.
I found that rather shocking.
Yes. And the woman in that, she was in Reno 911, which I was obsessed with for a while.
I didn't really care for that one. It used to come on, and I would kind of get stuck watching an episode.
Yeah.
And what is it about shows that are like really kind of borderline like that, where you'll watch an episode and you'll be kind of like, eh. And then
I think
some time will go by, and you'll be like, let me try it again. Let me just try another episode. Or you're stuck doing something else that comes on. And it's the same level fucking episode. You've watched this twice, and you've seen the same episode twice. I call this the small wonder phenomenon.
I actually think that there are... This happens to me a lot. I will say, like, I don't watch The Simpsons reruns too much on TV, but if I watch a Simpsons episode rerun on TV, it'll almost always be, like, the same three or four episodes. So I will say to my wife or my daughter or whoever's there, hey, look, it's one of the only four episodes of The Simpsons that exist. Specifically The Simpsons. I almost always see the episode where Marge and the kids become food bloggers. I've seen that episode like 35 times. And I'm convinced that apparently they only actually made four episodes of The Simpsons because that's all I see on TV. There are some TV shows that are like that. It's like, hey, look, it's the only episode of this. Hey, look, it's the only episode of that. That happens to me all the time. But then again, I have weird Oklahoma TV, so it's a bit different. I have a station here in Oklahoma just for Christian rap music.
Oh, that is pretty exclusive.
It's like Christian rock and Christian rap. My oldest daughter said, Daddy, how come we have a rap station on TV? And I'm like, we don't have a rap station? What the hell are you talking about? And we would argue about it all the time. It's like, Daddy, have you seen the rap station yet? No, I haven't seen the rap station. We don't have a rap station. We don't have cable. We just have regular TV. There is no rap station that exists. And then finally I'm like, oh, hey, you know that rap station? Oh, you saw it, Daddy? No, I didn't. What you saw was channel 14.3, which shows nothing but contemporary Christian hits for today's cynical youth. That was actually Christian rap. You were listening to Christian rap. Or, if you want to shorten that, crap. So, that's good. Christian rap. You see what I did there? I just combined those.
That was good. That was very good.
Thanks. when I go to Circle K, I like to combine Gatorade with lemonade. I like to get the Gatorade and then I add the lemonade to it, and I call it Gatorade. It's a combination of both of those names.
Yes, it is.
Yeah, Gatorade.
But I was
it's different
like,
than
what
Gatorade.
What would your Christian rap name be? What would be a good Christian hip hop name?
DJ Hallelujah. That would be my Christian rap name. I already have a rap name. I would like to take this time to say. I already have a rap name.
Okay.
My rap name is Early Bedtime, spelled all as one word and time with a Y.
Ooh.
Yeah.
That's bold.
Because I don't stay up too late. So.
Yeah.
Early Bedtime. Maybe with two Z's at the end. Double the Z, double the flavor. Bedtimes.
Yeah. The clock around your neck would just be permanently set to like 7.
Yeah. That's good thinking. Good thinking.
Yeah.
So, this week's movie.
This week's movie. Monster Zero.
Yes. Godzilla vs. Monster Zero. It also went by the name Invasion of Astro Monster. It came out in Japan in 1965. It came out in America in 1970 because, I don't know, we take a long time with Godzilla films, apparently. It was a joint Japanese and American film. It was produced by Toho and by the UPA station. It was the first time ever that the United States co-produced a Godzilla film.
Yeah.
As opposed to what we would usually do, which is just buy the rights to a Godzilla film and then add white people to it. This one was actually co-produced, which is different. It was directed by Ishiro Honda, and he's like a legend in the world of Godzilla movies. He directed the original Godzilla and King Kong vs. Godzilla and Mothra vs. Godzilla and Rodan and Destroy All Monsters, which everybody loves. He also directed some episodes of Ultraman, which brings it around, as we had talked about. He specifically directed the TV show The Return of Ultraman in 1971. And he worked for Kurosawa for his last 5 films, which is interesting to me.
As much as I love Godzilla, I have a lot of love for Godzilla. For some reason, my favorite was always Rodan.
Really?
So any movie that's got Rodan in it, I am down with. Yeah.
I always liked King Ghidorah, and I liked Mothra. King Ghidorah, I would have to say, has always been my my favorite.
Yeah.
He makes
such a great bad guy.
Yeah. Yeah, he does. Although, there were some Godzilla movies, I'm thinking of at least one Godzilla movie where he was the good guy. Because around the Heisei era of Godzilla films, they like to kind of switch things around. So there was one specific Godzilla movie where Godzilla was a bad guy. Godzilla in one movie was actually possessed by the souls of all the people who died in World War II, and he could only be stopped by King Ghidorah.
Which one was it?
It's one of the Godzilla versus King Ghidorah movies that they made either in the Heisei era or the Millennium era. I don't think it was the Millennium era. I think it was the Heisei. I might be pronouncing these wrong. There are different categories of Godzilla films. There are different they're broken into different eras. So there's the Showa series, which was 1954, the first Godzilla movie, to 1975, which is, I believe, Terror of Mechagodzilla. They started dark, and then they made this quick left turn into lighthearted, strange, bizarre, kiddie fare. If you're watching a film from the Showa series, you're either going to get a serious drama or a well-done Godzilla film or one of the stupidest movies you could ever see in your life. It really is like a toss of the dice
and
for the Showa series.
That's what I was raised on.
Yeah, yeah.
That's my era Godzilla.
Yeah.
You know.
So then, in 1984, they rebooted Godzilla, and that's the second era, and that's the Heisei era, or the Heisei, I don't know how to pronounce it, but it's from 1984 to 1995. They ignore almost all of the other films in the Showa series. And the bizarre thing about these movies is that all of these movies are set in a single timeline, and they have community, and they continuity. And some of the same characters.
Talk out a quick, amusing story about how I found out about the beginning of that period of Godzilla.
Okay.
1984, I was out of high school a couple of years, and I had a temporary job in the city. Okay, I lived out on Long Island, so it was a short commute to Manhattan. So I would get out of Penn Station, and I would walk to wherever work was, a few blocks. Whatever, and just walking through the streets of Manhattan with my head down, getting ready to cross the street, there's a big painted fucking Godzilla footprint, which is
really
one of the things I love about being in Manhattan. Yeah, because you just run across weird shit and you don't know what it's about.
Yeah.
Walked a couple of blocks further, I see another Godzilla footprint. And then it took like the next month for like posters to start appearing and things like that. The first one in that series, if I'm not mistaken, was Godzilla Returns. I forget the actual name of it.
In America, it was just Godzilla 1985.
Okay, yeah, but Raymond Burr, if I'm not mistaken, reprised his role in that one.
Yeah, in the American version, once again, like the original Godzilla, we took a really good Japanese Godzilla movie and added a bunch of white people to it.
Yeah. What were some of the other ones from that period, though?
Let's see.
Because I think I skipped that and went straight to Millennium.
After Godzilla 1985 was Godzilla versus Biollante. And that is considered to be one of the best ones, and it's a really bizarre plant-like monster that is created using some of Godzilla's DNA. Really interesting. And the whole series ends in 1995 with Godzilla versus Destoroyah, where they specifically kill Godzilla.
Yeah.
Godzilla dies in it, and Godzilla dies so that they can pave the way for TriStar in America to make their own Godzilla movie, which was Roland Emmerich and Dean Devlin's Godzilla, which came out in May 1998, and was an abortion.
Let me take a stand on that, okay?
Yes. Yes.
First off, not a Godzilla movie. Let's establish that straight off. Okay.
You know what it is? It's a disaster movie.
He's not a bisexual iguana creature. Okay, not a Godzilla movie. Other than that, it's not the best movie in the world, but it's pretty watchable. I've seen it a few times.
What I think is that Roland Emmerich and Dean Devlin, they were hot off Independence Day, and that was like the biggest thing in the world at that time, and everybody was nuts over it. So they followed Independence Day with yet another disaster movie that just happened to have Godzilla in it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's a good disaster film, and it seems to have, like, half of the cast of The Simpsons in it.
Yeah.
But it's And I just recently went to the movie theater and watched the Riff Tracks version of it live with my friend Allison, and it was fucking hilarious.
Yeah.
And it's funny because I didn't realize that my friend Allison hadn't seen Godzilla before, so the first time that she had seen this movie was the Riff Tracks version.
Yeah.
And so when Mayor Gene shows up, and his assistant, Roger, or however that was, she's like, wait a second, those guys kind of look like, no, like, you haven't seen this? No, that's supposed to be Siskel and Ebert. It's really stupid. I can't believe you haven't seen this before. Ed Gamow, Jerry Seinfeld. I can't believe you haven't seen this. But there's a specific interview that they did for some magazine. It was probably Entertainment Weekly or something like that, where
right.
they were asked, Emmerich and Devlin, they were asked, so did you watch a lot of Godzilla movies in preparation to make this movie? And they said, and I'm paraphrasing, but they said, oh, no, not at all. Those movies are all horrible. I mean, we tried to watch them, but all of those Godzilla movies are unwatchable, right? So that Godzilla movie is what you get when you get two guys who hate Godzilla movies and then give them $100 million and say, make a Godzilla movie.
Mm-hmm.
So now, thanks to last summer, we now know what happens when you get someone who loves Godzilla movies to make a Godzilla movie, and that was the last Godzilla movie, and that was pretty good.
I liked it. I don't know what, there was a lot of bitching about that movie, but I don't know what people want out of a Godzilla movie. You know,
my brother called me.
I would like to have seen more Godzilla in that movie, but like that's my only nitpick with it.
My brother called me, my older brother called me right after going to see the movie, and he said, hey, I just saw Godzilla, and I have a whole bunch of questions. And the conversation that we had leads me to believe that there was a lot of complaints about the film and nitpicking and stuff like that, but I think that a lot of those people who had complaints about the movie probably haven't seen a Godzilla film since the Matthew Broderick movie.
Yeah.
Because my brother started asking me these questions like, in this movie, Godzilla was a good guy. I thought he was a bad guy. Has he ever been a good guy before? And I'm like, oh, yeah, he's been a good guy in most of his goddamn movies.
Uh-huh.
And he was asking me questions like, oh, well, I wasn't sure if I liked it because Godzilla was hardly in it. It was just this big drama. And I'm like, oh, well, you know, I'm used to that. I'm used to going to see a movie for drama, stupid romance, drama, pointless backstory, Godzilla.
Yeah.
Drama. Stupid, overdramatic scene, monster fight, drama, Godzilla credits. That's what I'm used to because I've seen so many Godzilla movies.
And really, how much do you care about the human story in the Godzilla movie?
You don't.
And
that's why I'm excited for the next one.
I don't care who Nick Adams marries. I don't care.
Oh, Nick Adams.
Again.
I never knew too much about Nick Adams, so I tried to find out about Nick Adams because really I only know Nick Adams from this movie. Because I'm sitting here talking about the different categories of Godzilla films and the differences between the movies and different time periods and all that sort of crap. But when I was 9, I didn't know any of this stuff. I didn't have, the internet didn't exist when I was 9 years old. And there are so many Godzilla films, and they've been around for so long that it's difficult for, like, a small kid who wants to see a Godzilla film to sit down and watch a random Godzilla film because each and every Godzilla movie was completely different. But I was always drawn towards Invasion of the Astro Monster, Godzilla versus Monster Zero, because, you know what? I know that everybody else is just being dubbed, but I'm pretty sure this American guy is speaking English.
Yeah,
I'm pretty sure that, like, I remember being a little kid just, like, staring at those lips and going, wait, so he's not dubbed? Wait, but nobody else is speaking English? How the hell are they doing this? Why the hell are they doing this? That's just bizarre. But this was always one of the films that as a kid I was drawn toward. And I think it's because of that. Apparently, Nick Adams had quite a career. He had a small role in Rebel Without a Cause and was really good friends with James Dean.
I would not be surprised. I'm trying to find him on IMDb right now, but they're all gone.
Yeah, he was also good friends with Elvis Presley, and he starred in the ABC show The Rebel in 1959. And he made four different movies in Japan in the 60s.
Yeah.
The two biggest, though, are the big monster ones that he did. He did Frankenstein Conquers the World, and he did this one, Godzilla vs. Monster Zero. Although, in my house...
Frankenstein Conquers the World, because there was another white guy of note who did some Japanese movies. And I was thinking he did either Frankenstein Conquers the World or War of the Gargantuans.
I don't think he was in War of the Gargantuans, although I'm pretty sure War of the Gargantuans is the sequel to Frankenstein Conquers the World, but he's definitely in Frankenstein Conquers the World.
But Richard Tamlin, who is an actor who's been along for a lot of years, and he disappears. You know, he's one of those character actors. He fairly much started his career in West Side Story. So that's one of his big credits. And then he was Dr. Jacoby on Twin Peaks. For the Twin Peaks run. And then from there, he did... It's got to be War of the Gargantuans now that you say it. Because I was looking at him and I was like, his face looks so familiar. Who the hell is this dude? So I looked him up. And he was also in Frankenstein versus Dracula, another movie I absolutely love.
Yes.
You know,
that's a good one.
But yeah, Nick Adams was in more than one. I just got his credits here. I'm trying to see what else he's done, but yeah. And
he was nominated for
feeling as a kid, just being like talking English.
Yeah, in my house, this movie is known as Fujo Buddy. That's what we call Godzilla vs. Monster Zero, because any time that Godzilla vs. Monster Zero comes up, then I just picture Nick Adams and his beautiful, young, smiling, white, Aryan face just going, hey, sorry there, Fujo, buddy. Oh, looks like we're upside down. Hey, sorry there, Fujo, buddy, old pal of mine.
Mm-hmm.
I like to think that they're gay.
So we discover another planet in our solar system that's hiding behind Jupiter.
Planet X.
Planet X. Yeah.
Planet
really
X.
Imaginative they were with this particular movie. And
it is a surprisingly well done film.
It is not bad, but
the sets are amazing.
How much
I like
do you
the
feel
set.
How much do you feel they ripped off Final Wars from this movie?
How much did Godzilla Final Wars rip off Godzilla vs. Monster Zero?
Yeah.
I think they ripped off a lot of it.
With the, you know, it was another planet, it was people in black pleather or whatever it was that they were wearing and sunglasses. You know, it had a lot of the same characteristics.
Yeah. Well, amongst the Godzilla fan base, Godzilla Final Wars is seen less as a Godzilla movie and more as a remake of X-Men.
A remake of X-Men, really?
Yeah, because of all these mutants with special powers and they're having fights on motorbikes going down the freeway and...
Yeah.
Like, oh, no, I'm a good mutant. I have the power to choose. There's more of that than there are actual monster fights, which says a lot because, like, every monster in the world is in this goddamn movie. But Godzilla Final Wars, interesting that that movie was the last Godzilla movie that Japan has made, and that was 10 years ago.
Yeah.
It's been a decade since there's been a Godzilla movie that has come out in Japan. They're currently working on a new one, and that's exciting. And, you know, this will be like the reboot of Godzilla.
Yeah.
I think there should be like one or two extra re's in there. But I'm excited to see a Japanese Godzilla movie again. That should be good. You know what else creeps me out? You know what really creeps me out? I think I might be the only person who's thinking this, but in Legend Pictures Godzilla 2004, the American Godzilla movie that came out last summer,
right?
The husband and wife, you know, the star of the film and his wife, he's trying to get to his wife and kid, you know?
Right.
Mm-hmm. So they're married, they're husband and wife, but this summer in Avengers Age of Ultron, they're playing brother and sister.
Okay.
So the husband and wife who are...
Over in Scarlet Witch?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So the husband and wife in Godzilla are now playing brothers Quicksilver and Scarlet Witch in the next Avengers movie.
Yeah.
So automatically, I'm going to go into the Avengers movie and just think of nothing but incest. So thanks for that, Legend Pictures. That's really gonna be awkward. This is a surprisingly good Godzilla movie, though, Invasion of Astro Monster. It doesn't take itself too seriously, but it's not all comic. There were some really ridiculous Godzilla movies that were made during this Showa series. Specifically, there's one Godzilla movie that now is being retrofittedly called Godzilla vs. Ghidorah, but the original title was Godzilla vs. the Smog Monster. And it's a monster made out of pollution, and it's just one of the most ridiculous Godzilla movies that's ever been made.
Oh, yeah, I really hated that one. That one always just bored me.
There's a specific scene where, like, the young hero drinks so much that he sees everyone at the disco club as being fish.
Yeah.
And, you know, I drink, but I've never drank so much that I think everyone at the bar is a fish. I've never drank that much. Maybe there was something in the drink. I don't know. For a while, my kids were obsessed with Godzilla versus the Smog Monster. It was a difficult time.
It was, I can imagine. Very painful. Very painful. Bad memories.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
We usually wouldn't get too far into the movie, though, because my youngest daughter would call that film the cat movie. Can we watch the cat movie? I want to watch the cat movie. And she would watch it up until the scene where the smog monster covers a cat in sludge. And they show the poor cat covered in sludge, and it looks up at the camera and meows. And after that part, then she didn't really want to watch the movie. She just wanted to watch it to get, like, 30 minutes into the film to watch these Japanese people cover a poor-ass cat in slime and film it, and then move on to the rest of the film.
Yeah.
The cat movie. That was the cat movie for us. I just keep throwing stuff at my kids and hoping that it will stick. I showed my son some original Speed Racer cartoons the other day.
Yeah.
Really? And he liked them.
That is some classical training. Yeah.
Yeah. He liked them. He thought they were cute. For a while, my son was really into Clutch Cargo.
Yeah.
Clutch Cargo.
When I was a kid, the ones that I was really into when I was really young, when I was like Maxwell's age,
yeah,
was Speed Racer, Gigantor, and Kimba the White Lion.
Yeah. We've watched a lot of Kimba the White Lion over the last year because for some reason every library in Oklahoma, number one, has every single solitary episode of Dark Shadows. And number two is usually stocked with every episode of Kimba the White Lion.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah. The Norman Public Library, the Shawnee Library, the Tecumseh Library, they all are stocked with Kimba the White Lion DVDs. And I always thought, well, that's odd for just a random-ass small town in Oklahoma to be stocked with Kimba the White Lion, but, you know, whatever, I'm not arguing.
What I loved in particular about Speed Racer is, like, we would talk about Speed Racer in school, like kindergarten, first grade, shit like this, and discuss about how Racer X is really Speed's brother.
Nice.
Okay? Like, this was a revelation that only we knew. We figured this out somehow, that Speed Racer is really Speed's brother. And we would talk about that. And when is Speed going to find out? And then when I was watching it on as an adult, because MTV did a run of Speed Racer.
Yeah, they did.
Many years ago. So I rewatched them. They came on at like 11 o'clock at night. You know, so they were put on for me. And I realized that the narrative said it flat out in every single episode.
Yeah, they really telegraphed that.
It was part of his introduction. It was like, Racer X, who's secretly a Speed's brother.
Yeah.
Like, wow, I'm glad we figured that out.
Did you ever see the movie that they did, that big budget Speed Racer movie that came out a couple of years ago from the Matrix people?
Yeah, I did, and I want to get it. I don't own it, and I haven't seen it since it came out.
I never saw it.
It's bizarre. It's bizarre.
Yeah.
You know, you have to... It is loved and hated.
Is it on Netflix? I think it's on Netflix.
No. Let me check again, man, because I would love to see it again.
I never saw that film. Because there was a small period in time where everybody was like, oh, this is the next film from the guys who made The Matrix. And I'm like, yeah, but the last two sucked, and this does not look good. I'm going to stay far away from this. But I think that so much time has passed that I could really watch that and just love hating it.
Well, it's not on the stream. They probably have to get the disc. It's not on the stream. That's annoying.
Lame.
They did everything that they could to make a live action cartoon.
Yeah.
It's really interesting. It's really something to watch. The special effects are just shit you've never seen before.
Yeah, I mean, it looks beautiful.
You know, when they get into a race, they're racing upside down. You know, they're racing through, you know, ice caverns and shit. You know, just really weird stuff. You know?
Yeah.
So Speed Racer is, you know, you have to be, like, in the right mood for it. It's kind of like walking through a farmhouse, you know?
Yeah.
So I would definitely give it a recommend to try it out. Give it a chance.
Yeah, you know. Well, we'll have to try and find that because I really, really want to give that a try.
And especially since they did break my heart with The Matrix.
Yeah, they did. The first one was just a perfect film, and then the second and third ones were just
betrayed you?
The second one in particular betrayed me because they opened up such a kettle of fucking fish in the second one, and I was interested. I wanted to see how they worked this out. I wanted to see this movie take a dark philosophical science fiction turn, you know,
yeah.
And turn more like, oh, you know, Soylent Green or anything like that, where it has a stronger message to come through, you know.
Mm-hmm.
That's how the second one left me. And then we come up to the third one, and it's, okay, shit explodes in this one. Thanks. You know?
Yeah. I showed my oldest daughter the first Matrix. And she liked it. And then afterwards she said, hey, you know, let's watch the second and third one. And I went, you know what? We don't have to. Why don't we just skip the second and third one? Because it's not really necessary.
Uh-huh.
So I didn't show her the second and third one. I was almost embarrassed to show her the entire Matrix trilogy. Let's just watch this first one. You'll understand so many jokes from other movies. It'll be an entertaining film, and then we can leave it at that. If at some other period in time you want to watch it, you go ahead, but I'll be in another room.
Okay. We both have some things to do, so we might need to wrap it up a bit.
What movie should we do next week?
It is.
Do you have any?
What kind of mood are we in? Where have we not really been yet that we should?
How about a musical?
Musical. Let me check Netflix. Because they had Babes in Toyland, which I watched over the holidays.
I haven't seen that forever.
Okay. Babes in Toyland is still available on Netflix. It is a musical in every classic sense of the word.
Babes in Toyland.
Yeah, the set design and everything, it's everything from that kind of period, like, you know, Seven Brides to Seven Brothers and Little Abner, you know, any of the stage, really stagey kind of musicals.
Okay. I can give this a try. I can do this. I have a love-hate relationship with musicals. I can give this a try.
There will be fun talking points.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Plus I can talk about the musicals I like and the musicals I hate. I may have to go on a killing spree when they do, because the big thing now is to do live action plays. Live on television, NBC did The Sound of Music. Yeah, NBC, they first did The Sound of Music live, and it got massive, huge ratings, and then they followed that up with Peter Pan, and Peter Pan, everybody was talking about, whether for bad or for good, everybody was talking about that. So now all of the stations are kind of trying to get their own plays going, and sometime this year, Fox is going to do Grease, and when that happens, I may have to go on a killing spree because there is no musical. There are few musicals that I hate more than Grease. Maybe Hello Dolly,
But I really hate Grease. Just with a passion. I hate it so much. Ugh. But Babes in Toyland, I can give that a try.
Okay. Any homework thoughts?
Nothing that I can think of. Can you think of any homework?
Let me look for one, because I haven't looked for it. I'm pretty sure it's there. And I've mentioned this one before.
I thought of maybe assigning an episode of Fiffle and Ollie, the bizarre MTV sock puppet show, but like Cheap Seats, I can't think of a single episode to make people watch, so I don't have anything in particular.
Yeah.
I also thought of the episode of Gilligan's Island where they do a musical version of Hamlet, but that's not really available anywhere. It's available on YouTube, but it's one of those things where in order to get around the copyright, it's kind of like a super zoomed in episode.
Oh.
On YouTube. And I hate that. I don't want to force people to watch a super zoomed in episode of Gilligan's Island where everything is all framed wrong and shit. That's annoying.
Yeah. What I was thinking is not there. I looked on YouTube and I looked on archive.org. I was thinking of Superman and the Mole People. Mole Men.
Oh, yeah. No, that would be good.
So that's not there. Oh, yes, okay. This is short, okay?
Okay.
This is a tutorial I found, because I wind up looking up a lot of tutorials for different things. And I was looking for, well, what I found is a tutorial on how to make Hollywood-grade fake semen.
Okay.
Best tutorial I have ever seen in my life.
Really? Is it better than Michael Bolton's tutorial on award-winning softball?
I do not think I've seen that.
Because that's available on YouTube, Michael Bolton's winning softball. It's a wonderful tutorial from Michael Bolton on softball.
These are both. Mine at least is really fairly short, so why don't we watch both of them?
Okay.
For home.
So Babes in Toyland and your tutorial.
Homework. Michael Bolton on softball.
Yes.
And I'm trying to come up with my name. And I'll throw them both in the homework section on the YouTube page on Dead Cat Films. It's simply titled, How to Make Fake Semen. So if you look that up on YouTube, you should be able to find that easy enough. I mean, there are not a lot of them.
Good. This will be good. Good homework. It will be
entertaining and
yeah.
It will be...
And informative.
Huh?
And it's going to be informative because you're going to be learning things.
Exactly.
You're going to be helping out, changing people's lives.
Making a difference.
Yeah.
Michael Bolton on what softball?
Michael Bolton winning softball, I believe.
Winning
is what it's called.
Winning softball. Okay.
It should still be up on YouTube. I had it on my playlist for a while. On one of my playlists for, I think, cult movies. If you just search Michael Bolton softball, it should pop up.
Oh, here's something I've been meaning to ask you for a while.
Yeah.
I hope this doesn't keep us too long, but
okay.
Whatever happened to that father and son that used to follow their videos on YouTube?
Oh my God, Coleridge!
Coleridge!
And I forgot what the dad's name was, but I would just call him Femidaddy.
Yeah.
He's a teacher at some school in, I believe, Los Angeles. And no, one day I was really missing Disneyland, so I just searched Disneyland on YouTube, and the first thing that I found or watched was Coleridge's trip to Disneyland in 2005 or something like that. And it was just this little video that he did to the Cat Stevens song, Peace Train. And it was a weird video because at the end of it, he had a small clip of Coleridge in the bath, totally naked. And it's like, wow, you put this video of your kid up on YouTube and you're showing his junk to everyone? This is disturbing. And I just started watching all the other Coleridge videos, and I liked him on YouTube. He doesn't post much, but it's funny. He appears for a couple of seconds in the documentary Air Guitar Nation.
Really?
Yeah, because him and his bizarre femidaddy and his bizarre friends, they like to go out and have adventures, and there's one specific adventure that they had where they just said, hey, they're having an air guitar championship. Let's go, all dressed up. So they're in the audience fake rocking out during the documentary Air Guitar Nation. Really weird. I occasionally do check on Coleridge and Femidaddy. Coleridge is all super old now, but if Femidaddy doesn't post as much as he used to.
Yeah. But now, actually, though, the easiest way to find it would probably be to go right to your blog and do a search for Coleridge. That should bring up each of the articles that you posted about it.
Yeah, because I was obsessed with him for a while.
Yes, you were.
For a while, I considered him to be my unofficial other child.
Uh-huh.
In fact, I think on my Daily Motion page, which I haven't checked in maybe a decade, there still should be like a 10-second video where I'm just, hi, my name is Steve, and Coleridge is my child. Hopefully the dad has never... Daily Motion. Hopefully the dad has never discovered my obsession with him and his child. I'm pretty sure I could go to jail for the amount of obsession I had about him and his family. So, I do know that on his, he had a blog for a while. I'm not sure if the blog is still around, but he had like a blog where he would post all of his wacky adventures. And he went to a Comic-Con once because one of his friends co-created a TV show that was about to premiere called Avatar: The Last Airbender.
Right.
And he would write about, yeah, it's going to be premiering soon on an actual network, Nickelodeon. It's so great to have a friend and to see them be successful. He drew this picture for me of the head female character topless. So even before Avatar The Last Airbender premiered on Nickelodeon and was a huge hit, he posted on his blog a picture of whatever her name is, Katana? Is that the name? Is that the name of the girl from... Bella, help me out here. What's the name of the girl from Avatar The Last Airbender? Katana? Katara?
Katara,
yeah. Katara's boobs. I used to have an intimate knowledge of this man and his life.
Yeah.
Whatever school he teaches at, they have their proms in the back lot of Universal Studios.
I've also been thinking what our sign off should be.
Yeah.
Win Clan out.
Ah, yeah. My oldest daughter was obsessed with a series of kids' books for a while called the Warrior series. They still make them. There are about 50 books in the series now. But at one point, she just said, Daddy, can I go on warriorcats.com, and I'm like, I don't know what this is. Let me go on the website with you. And they have all these games and quizzes and stuff, and they have this thing where if you put your name and your birth date, then it will give you a warrior cat name and assign you to a clan. And I just, my name is Bramblestar, and I'm a member of the Wind Clan. I don't know what that means, but I'm going to be a proud member. I'm going to be the proudest member of the Wind Clan ever. And so, yeah, to this day, I still am a proud member, and will every once in a while end a blog post with Wind Clan out. I'm a proud member of the Wind Clan, just because a decade has gone by and I've never read any of these books and I don't care to. It doesn't mean that I can't be a proud Wind Clan member.
You have carried the torch well, if you ask me.
I have. I'm a vocal supporter of the Wind Clan.
Look how you have spread the word.
I have. Aaron Hunter, the Warriors series. I'm all about the Wind Clan. They're the best clan.
You have informed ones of people about Wind Clan.
Yeah. Because when people tune in to a podcast about movies, they want to hear about naked children at Disneyland.
Mm-hmm.
And they want to hear about cat novels for kids. That's what people really tune in for, to hear about the Wind Clan.
I know for as many podcasts as I listen to, I have not heard anybody mention it, and I feel that it's been very neglected.
Yeah, so you know what? We're really trendsetters. We're blazing a trail.
Uh-huh. Yes. We are breaking new ground.
We're breaking old ground and making it seem new.
Yeah. We are searching for that, you know, pushing the envelope.
Yeah. Or just breaking the envelope.
Or just breaking the envelope, yes.
Because we already broke the ground, so might as well break the envelope while we're at it. We'll just break everything.
There we go.
We'll just start breaking shit.
Okay, man, we both got stuff to do.
Yes.
So we must.
Yes, I need to go and check on Coleridge. I need to see how he's doing. It's been a while. He's probably sprouted.
The Coleridge report next episode.
And if you're interested, if you're interested to know what I'm talking about, just go on YouTube and search Coleridge Disneyland. He's right there. And there's a 50% chance that he might be naked, and that's weird.
I wonder how old he is now. Could he possibly, I'm really kind of hoping he goes emo. I really am.
I don't know, but every time I hear the song Peace Train by Cat Stevens, I smile now. It makes me feel better. It's such a cheesy song, too. Peace Train!
So next week we will be doing Babes in Toyland.
Yes.
And for the homework, it is Michael Bolton winning softball. And how to make fake semen.
Yes.
Okay,
I know how to make real, like authentic, but I don't know how to make any fake. So this will be
exactly a
learning experience.
Yes. Many of us have the skill of making real semen.
Yes.
You know, so this would be much more of a challenge, I guarantee you. And they will, as soon as I find them, I will put them both in the homework section on YouTube and at Undead Cow Films, where you can see Bob's Dirty Shorts. And, I am going to be coming out with a new series soon that I am calling Bob's Dirty Shorts, The Director's Cut.
Ooh.
Which is how I originally envisioned the show. But I really thought 30 seconds to a minute would be more for YouTube. But since nobody's watching them, I might as well go with the first idea, I'll recut it so it'll be a section of Bob, then a public domain cartoon, okay? Betty Boop, Superman, Popeye, something like that. Another section of Bob. A short film of some sort, which for a while I'm going to be alternating my own short films in, along with short films I just find along the internet or things like that. Another section of Bob, cartoon. Another section of Bob, the end.
Nice. Nice.
So they should run about half hour, 40 minutes each. Give or take.
All right. I can get behind that.
Yeah. So a little something more to watch when you're really, really high. You know, because I'm looking out for my fellow burners. And I really think
good thinking.
This is the entertainment that they need.
Good thinking. So do you want to do the spiel of all of our things?
That's as much spiel as I'm going to give for this one. You go ahead and spiel.
Okay. You can email us at our email address, which is something.
Hope at Undead Cow Films. That spiel. I thought you meant more other projects we're doing spiel.
No, I just wanted to get us to the point where we could talk about our Stitcher. Follow us on Facebook. The Pope on Film. Yeah.
Search Pope on Film.
Yeah.
Download the show on iTunes.
Yes.
That is best to find to do a search by Undead Cow, all one word, and that will bring up all the Undead Cow shows. So that's the easiest way to find us there. You can do a direct search for Pope on Film. That's YouTube. You can also, that's iTunes. You can also find us on YouTube at Undead Cow Films.
We have a Feedburner page.
We have a Feedburner page. The Feedburner page, that's just to get something in the way of statistics.
Yeah.
And it sucks. Have you checked out the Feedburner page?
Every once in a while.
Yeah. It's really all that.
And
we also have
a Stitcher page, of course. Don't forget about
the Stitcher. We are on Twitter at Pope on Film.
Yeah.
So you can find us on Twitter. And then, yes, there is our
Stitcher? Stitcher page! We have a Stitcher page. And the Stitcher page is just great. It's filled with so many Stitcher things that you would find on a Stitcher website and Stitcher. And there's a Stitcher thing, so you should, yes, Stitcher. And we know what Stitcher is, we're just not saying what Stitcher is, because we want you to figure that out on your own.
We are legally not allowed to discuss Stitcher on the
podcast. First rule of Stitcher, you do not talk about Stitcher.
Mm-hmm. Second rule of Stitcher?
You don't talk about Fight Club. Yeah. I love our
The only thing I can say about Stitcher is that there are a lot of dark forces involved with Stitcher.
I just scared myself right there.
You peed, a little pee came out of you, didn't it?
A little bit. Little bit just comes out naturally, but that time it was out of fear.
So until next week, I am Bunny Williams,
and I am Reverend Steve. Thanks for listening, America. Not so much other countries, just America.
Not so much other countries. Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks for listening. Thanks for listening, everybody.
See you next week.
Cut and print. See you next week, you godless heathens.
WinClan out.
WinClan out.